Welcome and good morning. I'm Simon McAllagher, one of the directors of the Knotted Project, and welcome to the second of GPLD's live series asking, Is the Future Rural? I hope those of you who went to the first film night last night had a great time. Don't forget, we have the second film night tonight at 8 p.m. and you can still book on via Eventbrite. Today, I'm being joined by a great bunch of guests who have all been involved with Great Place Lakes and Dales projects to support young creatives over the past 3 years. Before I introduce you to them, I'll quickly run through some pointers about how you can get involved with today's event. First of all, if you can make your browser window full screen, that means you'll be able to see the full extent of our show. And don't worry, if your internet's playing up, we'll be recording the whole experience and it'll be available after the event with transcription if needed. Secondly, we would love to hear from you with any questions you have for us during the show. This is your opportunity to get involved. To do that, we ask that you either open the Slido app or visit slido.com or scan the QR code you can see on the screen now. Slido can be purchased from your usual app stores, so it should be nice and easy. Either way, please enter the code hashtag GPLDLive and that will allow you to pose questions to us during that hour and I'll be able to see them and ask them to all our brilliant guests. So to start us off, I'd like to introduce Manon Kia, who many of you may already know as the programme officer for GPLD. Manon is going to remind us about some of the innovative projects and pilots that have nurtured some local creativity over the past 3 years. Hi Manon, how are you?
Hi, I'm very well, thank you very much. Very excited to be here.
Great, pleasure to have you. So let's jump straight into it. Manon, I know the programme has been jam-packed and varied, but what, in your opinion, have been the highlights and challenges of the past 3 years?
I mean, you're right, it has been absolutely jam-packed. There's just been so much that's been going on for the last 3 years, and it's really difficult to choose just a few highlights from, you know, such a wonderful thing where so many people have been involved. But I suppose if I have to choose, like, I'm going to kind of think about the things that I'm most kind of proud that we've kind of achieved in a way, because even though I wear my kind of creative hat the majority of the time right now, you know, underneath I do have a scientific hat as well. So from my point of view, the fact that, you know, we've used research, we've used expertise, we've used people's experiences from so many different backgrounds to actually decide what we should be doing and making the most of these 3 years. You know, we had a lot of different opinions about what should be done when we started, but actually we really wanted it all to be grounded on proper research and, you know, making sure that we were responding, listening, learning to the people around us and making sure that we made most of this chance to make a real big impact. So, like, you know, we did so much consultation, but also, like, the research that we did in 2018 really kind of that looked at the perceptions of young people about living and working in Craven in South Lakeland. And that told us so much that that's what we could base all of our work on. So things about spaces, so whether it's housing, workspaces, creative spaces, but also marketing and support for creative industries, young voices and culture, diverse programming and influencing strategies and policies were kind of the things that we really focused on because of that research. And then really kind of, for me, that's just making sure that actually what we have planned on doing is what people need, what they want, and hopefully the things that are really going to make those changes happen. So all the projects that we're going to hear about today are based on kind of trying to respond to what those people have told us. So whether it's The Fold or Create Your Future, Playworks Day, Innovate Your Offer, there's so many, Funding the Future, Hinterlands Aerial, Watch the Space, and so many of the other stuff that we've done with other producers, festivals, events and things. I'm kind of, that's a highlight for me that actually we can say that was all based on, you know, proper research and that actually it's hopefully something that can carry on in the future to make sure that we are able to kind of keep listening and keep learning as well. So that's kind of one highlight from my point of view that I can actually say, yeah, tick the scientific box there. But also that for me, kind of all those projects that we have done, it's a highlight just to see the response of people to those new things and new opportunities that we've put on. Because you know, they have been pilots, there've been new things, we've tried things out and tried to see what works and what doesn't. And it really feels like so many people have grabbed those opportunities with both hands, and that's a real highlight for me, that people have kind of jumped in deep end, not necessarily knowing what they're going to get themselves into, but actually really kind of built those relationships and taken that leap with us. So that's been a real highlight for me. Otherwise, it's kind of thinking about those creative champions. So I think Lindsay mentioned it yesterday in the episode, the first episode. It's about those meeting those people, young people all over Craven and South Lakeland, who might not even know that they're our creative champions, but they are, because they are basically doing what they love and telling people about it. And actually, what more can you ask for? Like, for actually getting other people to see themselves here as well. That's kind of just, you know, hearing about all the fantastic entrepreneurs and new ideas and ways that people have worked to actually make it work for them. And also kind of meeting and working from my point of view, you know, going moving from job to job, I always meet new people, but especially with this one, it's kind of meeting and working with incredible consultants and expertise, like experts and things in their fields, and all the new networks, and kind of they've opened up different worlds to me. So it's whether it's academic or marketing or like the new networks that they are part of, that's a real highlight. So yeah, there's kind
Amazing.
of a lot about the people. You kind of ask about challenges as well, which is always a tricky one.
Yeah,
But
go
for
for it.
me,
What have been the tough bits?
well, mission creep was a massive, like, a phrase that Lindsay and I got to know quite quickly, just because of the vast amount of opportunities that there are in this area. And also, kind of, it's such a big topic, and there's so many different factors that influence people's decisions about where they live and work. It was, you know, especially to start off with, it could have been easy for us to kind of go beyond what kind of our scope was. And I think because there is so much that needs doing, and also that there are so many opportunities, it's really important. And that's why it's so important that there are so many different people working together towards the same goal. So in a sense, that's been a challenge in terms of kind of focusing and thinking, right, what are we going to do? What can we do? What expertise can we bring to actually try and solve this issue? Also, for me, actually explaining to people in one sentence, what's your job or what do you do? What is Great Place? Because actually, it is such a big thing. So yeah, it kind of can easily turn into a half-hour conversation. That's still a challenge, really, but I'm getting better at it. There's
Absolutely. I
also,
like
yeah.
I've loved witnessing the program, and I think it's been great to see the kind of scope and the range of all the amazing projects that you've been delivering. I'm going to move us on, Manon, and I'm going to ask you the next question, which is the biggie. This is the big question for the day. So to really start us off on this, is the future rural? It's a big question.
It is a big question, and I'm glad that it's not just me that has to respond to it today. But for me personally, the future is always rural. I am from rural area, moved from rural area to rural area, really. I had 3 years in Liverpool. I've lived in Chester for a bit, but actually that was enough for me. I always end up living back in rural areas. So yeah, so for me it definitely is, but hopefully I think in the past year and everything that's happened has helped other people realize that that could be for them as well. And I think it has to be, really, for well-being, for creativity, and basically just having that work-life balance and kind of that sense of not living for the weekend. I think it has to be the way forward for everybody to have a bit more of a rural life. Maybe not completely, but actually, yeah, kind of making more of rural places, whether you live there or not. So yeah, from my point of view, yes. The future is definitely rural.
Thank you so much. It's definitely a sentiment that I kind of link up with, that idea of living somewhere and it being a lifestyle. So thank you for that. Manon, thanks for joining us and congratulations on such a varied and interesting programme of work. I know it's been fantastic. Before we invite our next guest, and now we know a little bit more about the background to what was needed, let's delve deeper into some of these projects. Firstly, here's a snapshot of some very exciting developments that have happened in Bentham during the past year. Amazing. What a cool film. Great to see some of those projects happening in Bentham. So, with that, let's move on to our next guest. As you can see, those fab flags and awesome murals were made as part of The Fold. And here to tell us a little bit more about the project are Lauren Zawadzki and Daisy Williamson from Deco Public, and Hannah Kessler, a musician and creative workshop facilitator from Kendal. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Great to see you. Thanks for joining. So we're going to dive straight into the questions, and Lauren, I'm going to come to you first. So Deco Public are well known for developing and producing amazing community-based festivals and events. Tell us a bit about the background of The Fold, how it evolved, and what the ultimate aim was.
Yeah, sure. So we're approached by GPLD in quite a relatively early part of their program. They asked us to look at what a cultural festival could be as part of the program. And when we sat down and did our research and started looking at the geography and looking at communities, I think one thing that really came to us is that it wasn't about delivering one festival or one program. We really wanted to work with the landscape, with the geography, and with multiple communities across the Great Plains, Lakes, and Dales area. We decided to work in three locations, and we picked them because we were interested about the travel times for public transport between Bentham, Settle, and Kendal, and what it was like to travel on public transport or a car, and some of the issues that young people face. Obviously, the programme was supposed to be live and it was supposed to be in person. We had to change that, but the absolute ethos around the whole programme that we developed was around co-design. And so we brought together groups of young people living in those areas. We did a call out. We asked local community groups to help us bring a group of people together. And we absolutely embedded co-design throughout the whole process of what the programs would be. And by co-design, what I mean is that the barriers are completely broken down. So everybody in the room is an expert. The young people are experts about being young people, about living in rural locations. We might be experts about putting on cultural events, putting on festivals across the whole of the north. But when you take down those barriers and you decide that everybody in the room has something really valid to say, you start to build a really authentic and meaningful program. And we've learned so much working through this program, but essentially that was the program that we set out to achieve. Like I said, it was supposed to be a live program. April last year, we decided to change all our plans, and it's just testament to those young people that we're working with that I'm actually more proud of what we've delivered with The Fold in its second iteration than what it was going to be in its first iteration. And it is entirely down to the young people that we've been working with, as to how that program's evolved.
Thanks, Lauren. That's brilliant. And yeah, an amazing project. And it sounds like you really handled the changes over the past year. So you talked about everything being led by young creatives. So, Daisy, can you tell me about your background and a little bit about your involvement in the project?
Yeah, of course. So I'm from a really rural area myself and went to Lancaster Uni to study art and had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do and wasn't set on a job in the arts because obviously everyone scares you off by saying it's such hard work and it'll never happen. So then I saw an internship opportunity with Deco Public and grabbed it. And right from day one of that, started working on The Fold. And I really feel that as the project has developed, like my skills have developed with it, and it's all down to that co-design process of me being allowed to be an expert in what I know. So the beginning obviously was building the brand and community engagement and researching in the area, and then co-design sessions with the young people, which blew all our preconceptions about what it might be out of the water. And then obviously COVID, as Lauren mentioned. And so, yeah, it's been a lot of redeveloping what we thought might work has changed into what now has really worked in digital ways. So, yeah, a lot of community engagement. It's been amazing to work with other young people, get to know other young people who are completely like smashing that idea of you can't have a job in the arts. So, yeah, that's it, really.
Awesome. Thanks. So we've already seen a clip about what's been happening in Bentham, but Hannah, you've been involved with activity in Kendal. So can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. So I attended the initial co-design sessions as a young person living in the area. And at that time, I was just working in a bar. And so I was sort of having to take time off shift to come to them, and I was in quite a different place to where I am now, sort of mentally. But I thought it was an amazing thing, and I was sort of in the point of my life where sort of a job in the arts just felt really, really unattainable, as Daisy said. But then I just found them both so kind of approachable and welcoming and warm. So I sort of decided to stay in touch with them. Even though COVID sort of happened. And then they asked Marissa and I to lead this zine project called Folded, which is an online zine showcasing work from creatives, sort of basically focused in sort of South Lakes, but kind of really anyone sort of in Cumbria, sort of in rural areas, sort of who is kind of a young person sort of in a similar position to Marissa and I. And it's been really interesting. I think it's been awesome kind of working with Lauren and Daisy, because they do have that sort of co-design ideal where me and Marissa are sort of used to being told what to do, but then they'll sort of say, well, what do you want to do? And it kind of forces us to really think outside of that very rigid kind of working pattern, and it's really kind of made me personally grow a lot and become a lot more independent, I think.
Amazing. Thank you so much, and congratulations on everything you've achieved. So I'm going to jump to a big question now for the three of you. Is the future rural? So Lauren, quick, short answers on this. Is the future rural?
I think if the last year has taught us anything, it's that there are some people in cities who've been very, very jealous of us. And I think the fact that we can show that these digital technologies have just fast forwarded what we already knew, is, which is we can work remotely, we can work in beautiful surroundings, we can work just as efficiently as anybody who's in a city. And I'm just so, so thrilled that, you know, we have had the opportunity, although how awful it has been, to make this project work remotely, to make it work digitally, and perhaps just to demonstrate in a different way that, it's just, I'm just so thrilled that we did get that opportunity to change this project. And despite all the horrendous situation that we've been in, we've definitely made this work, and the future is rural.
Thanks. Hannah, really short, snappy answer. Is the future rural?
I would sort of echo what Lauren said, and I'd say the future is definitely digital, but in order for it to be truly rural, I think there'd need to be some improvements in infrastructure out here.
Great, yeah, great suggestion. And Daisy, quickly from you as well.
Agreed. Agreed with everything. I think there are so many benefits to being in a rural area, whether that be like well-being, work opportunities, the space, you have the physical space. So yeah, 100%.
Great. Well, thank you all for chatting to me this morning. I look forward to hearing from you again shortly. Now we're going to be sticking with the youth-led theme by chatting with Beth Scholfer, an events management graduate and member of Fresh Perspective. So, welcome, Beth. Hi.
Hiya. Hello.
How are you doing today?
I'm not too bad. Not too bad.
Good. Well, welcome. We're going to jump straight into it, and I'm going to ask you the questions. So, you're a member of Fresh Perspective. Can you tell us a bit more about that and a bit more about what you've been doing?
Yeah, of course. Fresh Perspective is a collective group of young people who live and work in Skipton and around the area. And we aim to give other young people in the area a voice, so like give them a chance to be a part of the culture of the area. And we want to challenge their perceptions of Skipton and the Dales, so to prove it's not just like boring countryside. So recently we've been hosting workshops and planning projects with young creatives in the area, especially through our Joy in Numbers project. And we've been trying to get as many young people as we can involved. So, and like Sean said yesterday, we want to pay young people for their time. So no matter where they are in their career, we'd love to pay them so they get that experience of working creatively.
Amazing. It sounds brilliant. So how have things changed for Fresh Perspective over the past year? And do you think there have been any positives that have come from lockdown?
So initially, when we set up Fresh Perspective, we were going to plan a lot of in-person events, which obviously couldn't go ahead because of COVID, but now we're planning those once we can. But while COVID was happening, we moved all our events online. And while it would have been nice to have them in person to like, meet people, it's actually meant that we could reach a wider audience and connect with more people that we wouldn't have initially. So on one, like on a couple, we had people from London, Norwich. There was even a lady from Mumbai got onto one of our workshops. So it was like amazing that they'd even heard of us. Oh yeah, so there's been ups and downs with it.
Amazing. So, Beth, I know that living rurally and rural events are close to your heart. How are they different to events that usually happen in cities?
So I'm biased because I love living in the countryside, but I just feel like there's more of a community with rural events. Like people in the area are more likely to like help out. So where I live, it's quite a small village, but if I put on event here, people would be like, "Oh, I know someone who can like bake you some food to sell there," or "I know a band that'll play for free." And it's just more of a community. And I feel like there's so many amazing connections to make with creatives living and working rurally as well, and they might not have had that opportunity if you put an event on in the city. So you can work with artists that live rurally and get them involved. Plus, who wouldn't want to have an event rurally when you've got the Lakes and Dales on the doorstep? I feel it's such a nice place to have an event.
It is a beautiful place to be. Thank you, Beth. Thanks so much for that. I'm now going to ask you to stay there while we bring back our other guests. So we've got Manon, Lauren, Daisy, and Hannah coming back to join us for our first panel. Hi, everybody. Great to see you back. So I'm going to go straight to our slider because we've got some fantastic questions coming in. So let me find a couple of good ones. So I've got a question for Lauren. For anybody watching who would like to help amplify the voice of young people, have you got any top tips about where to start?
Yeah, well, I would say the first thing is that let the young people amplify their own voices, and support them to do that. So I think all too often, like Hannah said, people like me, because I'm not young, think that, okay, let's do a great program for young people and then try and devise the program for young people. But that is honestly the worst thing to do because you will get it so wrong. So it's definitely about engaging the young people in an appropriate way, making them feel that it's not a program for them, it's with them, and giving them the opportunity to tell them exactly what they want to do and putting that support mechanism in place. So, you know, I would really encourage people to look at co-design principles, read about it. It really, really has helped my practice and my business. And we'll carry on in all our projects, not just working with young people, but all different kinds of communities.
Amazing. Thanks. Great answer. So, Hannah, from your experience, what is the biggest barrier to young people taking things into their own hands and making things happen in rural communities?
Honestly, I think the biggest barrier is confidence, self-confidence, because, so I, just full disclosure, I grew up in London and it's very, very different place. And there's this kind of preconception that sort of people who live in cities are sort of more creative and sort of more intelligent than people who live in the countryside. But that's just not true. There's just more access to resources and other people. But in sort of here, like in Cumbria, there are so many people who are just utterly brilliant in every single way. They are, you know, completely inventive, doing completely new things. And there's just not the sort of, there weren't the resources to sort of connect these people and help them build a community. And I think that sort of leaves each person feeling a little bit inadequate. They haven't got that chorus of voices saying, yeah, go for it, every time they have an idea. So I think it's really, really important that any kind of arts organisation who's trying to help improve things in the rural areas really focuses on building lasting connections between these young creatives, because then when left to their own devices, they're going to just do things, because that's what creative people do. Like since, just as an example, I'll stop soon. Since we started Folded, we've had people wanting to put on plays, and I had someone email me just yesterday asking if he could facilitate a forest-based exhibition, and just all these incredible things are starting to happen, and it's only been a few months. So I think it really can be done. People just need that little push.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Yeah, totally agree. Beth, I've got one for you. What is your favourite workshop? What was your favourite one?
Oh, I really don't know. See, we did an embroidery workshop, and I've had the set, like an embroidery set, for over a year now, and it's just been collecting dust. So we did one with Lana Grindley from Love Art Workshops, and it finally made me use it. So I've been like embroidering all my dungarees now. So I've got flowers on everything. So, but there's been so many great ones. Like Verpy did a really good one with the stop motion. We had Craven College do some like special effects makeup. So that was for Halloween. And that got a really good response. Everyone loved it because they got the free pack. They could do it themselves. And although we couldn't celebrate Halloween, it felt like everyone could get together and do something. So there's been loads, but yeah.
Love it. Manon, I'm going to come to you. Really quick answer for me, just so we can keep on track. So young people continue to lead on many global issues as activists. Because of this, can you see a shift in how young people are perceived in their communities?
Absolutely. I think, you know, it's been happening over the last few years, but absolutely, like with all different campaigns and stuff that young people have been the leaders of, I think it has to be the way, like, you know, they're the ones with the loudest voices and the power to actually do something in their local communities right now. So yeah, I think it has made a start, and I think it's only just going to get better with their voices being even more heard. Yeah.
Awesome. So, Daisy, finally, how can we enable more activities such as the Fold to get out to remote villages where it's difficult for young creatives to get involved?
Sorry, my connection just went a bit there.
That's fine, I'll repeat. So how can we enable more activities to get out there into our kind of remote villages so that young creatives can access that?
I think it's partly something that we've tried to do with the Fold, like show that anyone can do it. You don't have to be an expert at embroidery, for example, to do an embroidery workshop. So it's not a case of bringing people into these locations. These people are already there, encouraging these people to think like, yeah, actually, I'll share my skill. And I think that's all it takes. Like Hannah said, it's a confidence thing, empowering people. These people are here already.
Amazing. Thanks. So thank you to our first panel. Brilliant to chat to you. Now, just a reminder that if you've got any questions for our panel later on, remember you can still use the Slido app and you can put all your questions there. You can access that by scanning the QR code that you see here or going to slido.com. Okay, so either way, please enter the code hashtag GPLD2. That will allow you to pose questions to us during this hour, and I'll be able to see them and ask them to all our fabulous guests. So thank you all so much. We'll see you soon.
Thanks.
Great.
So my job is Head of Participation and Learning for Lakeland Arts. I guess what that means is trying to engage people into the organisation, to engage people with culture, with the heritage of their area, and also with visitors who come to the area to see a bit more about what we have here in South Lakeland with the Lake District and also Kendal. Yeah, I used to be a teacher and I kind of moved into the museum art gallery sector just so that I could have the freedom to think more creatively. My work increasingly is more about project management, so it's working creatively with different organisations that might be film directors or dancers or artists on creating different ways in which we can connect with people. So there are different trusts and foundations which you can apply for money to do significant projects. In the past we've had money from the now called National Heritage Lottery Fund, but we get money from places like the Claw Foundation, we get money from Esme Fairbairn, so there's a variety of different organisations that fund, I suppose, cultural organisations to do more. Best Day is, I would say, is definitely seeing one of our venues very active, so seeing it very full of people engaging and enjoying what they're doing, but also workshopping an idea and coming up with a solution to that in a creative way. I mean, so the advantages of being in someone like this is that it's absolutely beautiful. There's a real clean air. You know, people that I work with have lived in cities, have moved up here if they've had bad asthma, and they, you know, there's an absolute change in their quality of life. Essential to an organisation like this, where we have four different sites, is a shared aim and objective, and clarifying what that is for everyone who works from the front desk, to people who work on the boats, to people who work right up to the chief exec, is to having a bit of a shared vision. You know, creativity is a really interesting way of engaging people, but also enabling people to connect, to be listened to be appreciated, and you know, the ways in which we do that allow that to happen. And if creativity takes you to a different place in the country or a different place in the world, fine, go and get that training. But do come back and share with people what you've learned and your creativity.
So that was just one of a series of films that have been created as part of GPLD's Create Your Future project, which helps showcase hidden careers in the Lakes and Dales and supports resources to schools, colleges and career advisors to share the diversity of career opportunities in the area with budding creatives. Now on to our next guest, and joining me now is Ian Reid, who, as you saw in that clip, works at Lakeland Arts. Hi Ian, how are you doing?
I'm good. That was a long time ago.
I know that feeling. Well, thanks for joining us today. I'm going to get straight into there with the questions. So tell us from your point of view, why is it important that we have more young people choosing to live and work in the area?
I think it's fairly straightforward, isn't it, that any great community, any great society has a richness and a diversity. And I think young people bring an element of that diversity. And if it's slightly lopsided, it's not a great community. It's not a great thriving society. But more than that, I think places that are rural tend to not attract young people, and they are the places where we need that freshness, that spirit, that diversity and challenge of the norms. We can often too often hark back to kind of heritage and old practices, and actually young people bring a different perspective that we need, I guess, is a simple answer.
Amazing. Yeah, I completely agree. So Ian, your career has taken you to different parts of the country. What is it that drew you back to the lakes?
That sounds really grand. I haven't really been all over the UK. It's pretty much been the north, and I haven't really strayed much further than the M62. What drew me back to the Lakes? I guess it's simple, isn't it? There was an opportunity, and I think that's what young people are looking for too. So there was an opportunity. I fulfilled that opportunity, and I came back. There's no more romantic notions about what the Lake District means to me, or the water and all that kind of stuff. But I have, over these last 2 years, really appreciated the space that a rural area gives me, and I enjoy thinking in those spaces and being able to be creative. Also, I think, you know, from the cultural sector, you can be a bigger fish in a smaller pond if you want to move things around and change things up. It could be quite exciting for young people to stay and seek those opportunities.
Great, yeah, I completely agree. I think it highlights the importance of making sure that opportunities are in this area for young people. My next question for you is, if you could give someone thinking of starting a career in the creative industries one piece of advice, what would that be?
Okay, one piece of advice, it's kind of like a long piece of advice. And I think it starts with the fact that pretty much every single arts organisation that I know of will have written the word young people into their business plan, into their fundraising strategies. They will have put these people in the forefront of what they want to do and achieve. They don't always know how to do it. So I think my biggest piece of advice would be, if you were wanting to get into the creative sector, would be to have an idea, map what that idea is, budget it, and then find out who your local CEO is, your artistic director of your favorite venue, someone that shares your values and vision, and send it to them and arrange to meet them and, you know, knock down that door, because these people do not always know how to do that. And we need people to come forward and say, look, I have this great idea. This is how much it will cost you. This is how it will benefit you and me. And here it is. And I've done all the work for you. And I guarantee that every single arts organization in Cumbria will have put down the ambition to work with and co-produce with young people. And we need those young people to knock at the door and say, here, this is really dead easy for you. And it's, you know, and that's, you know, that's my piece of advice to all young people. And they will be met with, you know, with generosity of spirit. People do love talking to young people. So, you know, that's it. Do that. One advice, do that.
Great. Thank you, Ian. Yeah, that's great to hear from your perspective. And yeah, I completely agree. It's about being proactive in this area and putting yourself out there and being confident with it, which is easier said than done sometimes. But yeah, thank you, Ian. So Create Your Future is just one of the ways that GPLD has inspired and supported emerging artists. On to another project now. It's fantastic. So back in September 2019, young creatives from across the north were invited to a residential training weekend called Play, Work, Stay. Here is a short video about it all.
This weekend has been about bringing young people together and supporting them to develop their creative skills and to encourage them to kind of stay in this place in the Lakes and Dales and to continue to grow their businesses here rather than seeing London as the place to go.
For me, this weekend has been about having the opportunity to meet new people in similar situations to me and try and building those connections, and hopefully the connections will remain and we can all sort of skill share with each other, and maybe collaborative work will happen and artwork will be created out of it. But I think the most important thing is being able to have a group of people who can hold each other accountable to actually getting where they want to be.
What we hope people take away from the workshops is to really grasp your dreams and really grasp that ambition. Getting an opportunity like this as a young person to really grasp hold of what you're passionate about and start that from day one, I really hope they take the opportunity to really follow their passions and go against the grain, because when you do that, you can create great opportunities.
So I got out of those workshops mostly the value of teamwork and collaborating with other people in order to come up with a creative result at the end.
Well, I've taken away way that I need to treat my creativity with a bit of care. So I need to not just drain it all the time. I need to like water it a bit and put some fertilizer on there and, you know, actually do things that are just fun in order to do more things in my creativity.
I think in the north it's important to support creativity because we're a more sparsely populated area. There's a lot more rural communities here, and having creativity built into the community is so important to enriching everyone's lives.
Hi again, welcome back. So here to tell us a bit more about Playworks Day are Karen Merrifield from Innovate Educate, poet Hannah Hodgson, and mixed media artist Marissa Crane. Hi everybody, thanks for joining us today. How are you all?
Good.
Great, well, I'll jump straight into the questions. So thank you for coming along. Hannah and Marissa, you both attended Playworks Day. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience? Hannah, I'll ask you first. Can I hear you, Hannah? I'm so sorry, Hannah, I can't hear you. So I'll move on, okay? And hopefully we'll get you back in a second. So I'm gonna ask that same question to Marissa. Can you tell us a little bit about Playworks Day and your experience?
Yeah, so it came as a bit of a turning point in my creative practice because I'd graduated from uni, I did fine arts, and I'd been back from uni for a while and I hadn't done any art, I hadn't done anything creative, so I felt a bit stuck, and this experience and this like residency really gave me the confidence, not only in my own practice and having a future in the arts, but that there was a community of young like-minded people around me even that when I'd left uni, even though I was back in a rural area. So yeah, it just really gave me that confidence and inspiration to kickstart my practice again.
Amazing. And can you tell me about how you used what you learned at Playworks Day? So yeah, Marissa, how did you apply it?
Well, the quote that stuck with me the most out of all the talks was, you don't have to be an expert to start. And that again just really helped me find my curiosity and like playful side in my practice again, and not being afraid to start, which is obviously the biggest hurdle to get past, is just getting like pen to paper or paint, you know, paintbrush to canvas or whatever. So it just really helped me, yeah, understand that mistakes don't mean failure and mistakes can be good things, and you don't know what's going to come out of your practice, and especially if you don't start. So just not be worried about that first starting point and just dive straight in.
Brilliant, thanks so much. Hannah, have I got you back? I think we're still struggling with the connection with Hannah. So Karen, can I bring you into the conversation? Good to see
yes,
you.
Yeah.
So Karen, you've been working as GPLD's business relations consultant with JL Williams for the past couple of years. Can you tell us a bit about how the idea for Playworks Day came about?
Well, Playworks Day was a real team effort, and it came about as a result of consultation and then conversations, really. Great Place Lakesandales recruited three sets of consultants into the project quite early on. Jill and I were recruited to look at the business aspect, and so that's the business landscape in relation to young people in the area. Richard was recruited to look at infrastructure and policy and public art and affordable housing, all of those things. And then Francely and Emily were recruited to look at creative practice, so scoping creative practice across the area and looking at what support might be needed. And we were all carrying out research and consultation separately. And then we started to have conversations and we realized that a lot of the, we're covering the same sort of themes, but through a slightly different lens. And when we'd carried out the research, the next step was to look at the sorts of solutions that we could put in place. And so we all had sort of various different ideas, but Playworks Day, that emerged from a sort of a real need for young people who had left formal education, who wanted to start a creative career, who wanted to have a career in the cultural sector. And there was very little out there for them. And we realized that sort of a pure business course would not be attractive to the young people who we were trying to communicate with. So I think it was because of those three strands, the creativity, the business and the place, that's what made Playworks Day work. And I think that the importance of the location was key. It was sort of, it's about health, well-being, inspiration, and then bringing together creative practice and the skills that you need to have a successful creative practice.
Brilliant. Thanks, Karen. So obviously you created Create Your Future and Playworks Day, but can you tell us a little bit more about the other projects and schemes that you also worked on?
Well, as I say, we started out with research, and the first thing that we found was that there were four key themes that were coming out. One was that young people weren't really aware that they could have a creative career or a career in the cultural sector. The second was an issue around appropriate workspaces and places. The third was appropriate business skills. There's lots of business support out there for startups or scalable businesses, but there's very little to engage young creatives. And the fourth thing that we found was that there's all sorts going on in the area, and it's brilliant, but it's, wouldn't say it's a well-kept secret, but people tend not to shout about it. So the solutions that we looked at were addressing those four areas, and everything we did was based on live issues, live things that were important to young people in the area, so live briefs. So we did Playworks Day, Create Your Future. But we also did a couple of workshops, which obviously you were involved with, Innovate Your Offer, which brought together some more traditional businesses, the creatives and the cultural sector. And what we were trying to do there was to look at the potential for people to work differently, to open up markets to the creative sector, but also look at how the three sectors could work together to support their communities. And we ran that workshop again last year, and that was to look at medium to long-term recovery from COVID. And the thing that came out of that was that creativity was going to be key, community was going to be key, and collaboration. So I thought there was quite nice themes to come out of that piece of work.
Great. Thanks, Karen. So from the themes that you outlined there, it seems that one that's potentially the most tricky to crack is providing suitable workspaces for people working in the creative industries. Marissa, is there anything you want to add? I know that Hannah, we're still trying to work on getting your sound ready for us, so hopefully we'll get that back very soon. But Marissa, yeah, what's your opinion on creative workspaces?
Yeah, well, creative workspaces are so important, because particularly if you're a visual artist and you need space to make things and get a bit messy, particularly like I'm a mixed media artist, so I do quite sometimes large scale sculptures and things that you need a lot of space for, and somewhere that you can make a bit of a mess and feel free to do that. And if you have no space, then you've got nowhere to work. So you've kind of already stumbled at that first block again. You might have an idea, you might want to make something, but if you've got nowhere to make it, then how are you going to do that? And then even if you do manage to make some work, then you've got the issue of photographing it. So if you've got no clear space, a coveted white gallery space to photograph your work in, then you can't make a portfolio, which means that you can't put your work online, you can't put it on a website, you can't put it on socials, and then you don't have a portfolio to, you know, go and get jobs or apply to exhibitions. So it's so important to have that space that's accessible, particularly for younger artists who have come out of uni and had all these facilities and all this space and now just have nothing and are a bit shocked and a bit stunned and don't quite know how to get a space. And also to have that community as well, you've gone from this big group of cohort of people you've been working with, sharing ideas with, and then all of a sudden you're on your own with no space and no one to bounce ideas off.
Cool. Thank you so much for sharing all that. Yeah, it's a massive challenge. I've really enjoyed chatting to you. Thanks for joining us and for that really interesting chat. Identifying the pivotal changes that are going to make a real difference is essential. But as we've already discussed this morning, it's not always easy to make sure that younger voices are heard. One way that GPLD is supporting young creatives in the area is to put their views at the future front and centre. Here's a short clip that shows how this might be done.
I'm Sula, I'm 33 and I live in Kendal. I do illustrations, drawings and sculpture. Income from creative work is hit and miss. Sometimes you can be doing really well and sometimes not. So I always have a part-time or a full-time job on the side. The inspiration for the Land Lumps came from a lot about living in the Lake District. There's a lot of rocks and trees and leaves and things, and just a love of always liking like world building. You can go out pretty much any day, anywhere, and see something really beautiful. With the internet, you don't need to be in a big city to be able to access opportunities and an audience. So you kind of get the best of both worlds here, really. I would definitely want to keep developing the Land Lumps and making more work. I'm working on a range of greetings cards and wrapping papers and stickers. And I'd love to be able to publish a book one day.
My name is Louisa and I'm based in Kendal. I'm 23 years old. My creative work is mainly hobby based at the minute. So I love playing guitar and singing. It's just my like escape. When I was like 12, 13, that's when really like my passion with music started. If I think of like the music scene in the Lake District, it's like cozy pubs and bars or like outdoor kind of spaces. Around here I'm performing in front of people 30 years older than me with their families, like people my own age. It's just such a mix of faces, but it's still got that community spirit to it, which is just what I love so much. Here, you can find places and just be on your own, which I think for things like music and finding your creativity and, you know, all of that, it's definitely important for me. Just walk through the expanse of the Lake District and find like some of the most gorgeous places and just see no one around you for miles. Like, it's amazing. It's got a special place in my heart.
Gregory Webzel, I'm 26, I'm based in the Lake District. My main sort of income is my ice cream business that I run. I also throw my own mini festivals. For this latest festival I created last year, it's called Peddler's Rest. It's a platform really for emerging artists to come and have a go on really. Where we have it, it's sort of a peninsula that sticks out into the lake, so you get like a full 360 degree views of the lake. So you get the sunrise up at one side of the lake in the morning and then amazing sunsets in the evening at the other side. It's truly a gorgeous place to be in. And it's just so nice when new people come to the area and they're just amazed by the scenery. What I'd like to see in future of my events is continued growth in the attendance and turnout. More music, different varieties, hopefully multiple stages.
I think my ideal view of the future in 5 years' time would be the continuation of like more spaces popping up in the area, because art is such, it's a fundamental human activity. I think it'd be really good to have a hub of advice for artistic practitioners, and just to help people get an idea of what they have to do to maintain a creative life.
If there was a funding pool available, that would be useful, because it would just broaden the horizons of what you can offer. You should be in a position in the future where everyone's paid.
There definitely isn't enough public transport in this area, and that's the number one thing that I'd change. We've got a community in the Lake District, but it is a vast amount of space. That I see amazing things for this area in the future, not gonna lie. I see absolutely incredible things.
So, as Greg mentioned there, one of the biggest barriers to creativity is often funding. To break down this barrier a little, in 2018, GPLD launched their Branching Out and Acorn funding schemes. To tell us a bit more about that, I'm now joined by Lisa Jameson, who works with GPLD as a fundraising consultant. Hi, Lisa.
Hi, Simon. Great to see you.
Lovely to see you too. Thanks for joining us today. I'm going to dive straight into the questions. We'll go fast and furious. So as we've already mentioned, getting funding can be a big block for many creative and cultural organisations, as well as individuals. Can you tell us a bit more about the core stumbling blocks young creatives in particular encounter when they're trying to access funding?
I think it's something of an uphill battle for them, to be honest, all the way. And I think the first time is always the worst time. So without a track record of securing funding and delivering projects, it can be difficult to convince funders that you're somebody who's worth backing. And then I think the other barrier they face is sometimes just a lack of knowledge about where to look for those applications, what the types of questions might be, what the processes are that you have to go through, and therefore how to articulate your ideas and your strengths and your possibilities really strongly.
Thank you. Yeah, I totally agree. It's a big challenge, and yeah, putting yourself out there is really important, and making sure that you talk to the right people who do know about this, because there's often a big knowledge gap. My next question for you, Lisa, how did GPLD's Branching Out and Acorn scheme aim to remove these barriers?
I think we worked on two fronts. One was the funding, and then the other was the support. So the funding schemes, we were very, very clear and specific about who they were for and the types of projects that we wanted to support. And we went out and kind of sought those applicants and sought those people amongst our communities. And we were really clear that we definitely wanted early career, young people, new entrants to the field. We kept the application form really short and really snappy, so we made it as easy as possible to put your proposal down on paper. And we were willing to take a risk. You know, we were willing to give somebody a go, give them a shot, give them their first opportunity. So those were the funding schemes. But actually, so much more than that, it was the support that went around the funding. So it was the advice surgeries, the one-to-one coaching and mentoring sessions, the networking sessions, even some of the training opportunities to fill those knowledge gaps that you referred to. So it's the two things working in tandem. Yes, there's money to deliver a project, but more importantly, there's wraparound support for people there.
Thanks, Lisa. Yeah, I'm a recipient of Acorn funding through the Knotted Project, and we know that the funding and the relationship was massive. It was really important and a big part of it. My next question is linked on those relationships. So building those relationships with people who receive the funding is one of the great things is that it makes it more easy for you to kind of pass on those connections and make those introductions. How do you think this has influenced the longer term impacts of the funded projects?
I think through these funded projects and the Creative Champions, we've created this community across the Lakes and Dales of young, energetic, entrepreneurial creatives who now are connected to one another, both virtually, like in situations like this, but also before COVID, we were able to bring them together face to face, meet and talk and share. And so that building those relationships has kind of created this glue that sticks the projects together. So we don't just have individual projects, it's actually a collective effort across the region to change the region. And by creating that community, they've been able to support one another, to share ideas, to offer advice, to collaborate. So yes, there's been the relationship with GPLD and the advice and support that we can give, but there's also been that brilliant peer support of people feeling connected to, you know, they've found their tribe kind of thing.
Yeah, I think that's amazing. Thank you so much for your comments. And Lisa, if you stay there, we're going to bring back the others. We've got Karen, Hannah and Marissa joining us again for our second panel of the day. So welcome back, everybody. Hopefully we've got Hannah this time, and hopefully everything works. Hannah, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
Yay. Fantastic. So great to have you back. And yeah, I'm going to go to our Slido for some questions. So Lisa, I'm going to come to you. Lisa, what would you like to see funders do to make support more accessible to emerging artists or those who haven't applied for funding before?
Oh, great question. So, I mean, do what we did on GPLD, offer some really good support and training and investment in those individuals as well as the cash. And I think also there's something about devolved decision making. So trying to work at a national level, I understand that that is challenging for funders to find those individual new pieces of talent. So devolve that decision making to local people and local organisations who have that knowledge and who have those networks and who can work from the bottom up to invest early days in new individuals, building them, developing them, enriching them so that they're then ready to step forward onto a national stage and apply for much bigger sums of money.
Amazing, thank you. So I've got one for Hannah. Can you tell us your favourite bit of Play Works Day and just give us a sense of what your main takeaway was from that?
My favourite bit has to be working as a freelancer and as a creative freelancer, because that was unlike anything I'd accessed before. It really made me see myself as a professional. And it being my hobby, but it's a job. And that was something I really needed, especially given this last year. So I've been working from home for a full year because I've been shielding. So it has been instrumental in a way I didn't know at the time it would have been. It has put me in contact with an array of people that I didn't previously know and still wouldn't know if I hadn't been on that weekend. So it did really help me.
Great, thank you so much for that. That's great to hear from you. Karen, creative sectors in cities are a key part of their economy. Do you think that the same applies in the Lakes and Dales? And if not, how can we change this?
I think I'm a real believer in trying to retain sort of talent and not letting the talent sort of slip out of whichever area down to London and the big cities. So I think it is about raising awareness and sort of the connectivity around young people as well, so that they are sort of greater than the sum of the parts, if that makes sense. So what we try to create with Play Works Day was to provide young people with the skills to create the visibility of the creative career, but to create the networks as well. And I think that's the key to having a successful creative sector in rural areas, really.
Brilliant, thank you. Ian, I'm going to come to you. Earlier, we talked about young creatives pitching to local arts organisations. Are there any particular opportunities that you think they should be looking out for?
Who, the young people or the arts organisations?
Yeah, the young people, is there any way that they can have an easier way into these organisations to start these conversations?
I mean, in this kind of digital age, you can find out you need the name of the people, right? So you need to know the names of the directors. And if they've hidden their name on their website, call the office and find out who they are. I mean, you know, be dogged. I think that's it. These people need you. Otherwise, there will be this kind of creative drain. So, I mean, look at the Arts Council Let's Create strategy. That's all about kind of putting creativity in the hands of the people that are creative. And so, you know, it's absolutely within their gift to do this right now. Arts Council are saying to people, the creativity lies with you as well as it does with those who are at the top end of the spectrum, who are, you know, making a lot of money from this. So, you know, be bold. You know, find out who these people are and contact them. If you want to contact me, and I've got the ear of the chief exec, so I can put you in touch.
Great. Well, that's a great offer from Ian. Take him up on that. Yeah, my top advice from a personal perspective is make sure you call people as well. Don't rely on just emails. Make sure you pick up the phone and start that conversation. Yeah. You can do it. So who haven't we heard from? I want to talk a little bit about the big question today, is the future rural? So Hannah, is the future rural? Can you help us answer this?
It is, but I would plead, especially because of our rurality, that we continue to stay online, because I have a physical disability and this area is very sparsely populated, and I've gone from being able to do maybe 2 things a week to 10, 12, 15 things a week because it's been online. So it is a strength that we are rural. Our networks are a lot closer, but I wouldn't like to go back to what we were pre-pandemic, because just to pick something out of the air, one of my best friends hasn't been to an arts event in 10 years because they've been bedbound, and because of COVID they've been able to. So I think it's important that we remember what we've learned and don't just write off this time as being an awful thing.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. So on that respect, if GPLD ran another Playworks Day and we could do it digitally and keep that alive, what would that look like and would it work? Do you want something like that?
I think it would still work. It would work differently, and it does require, so you have to think about screen breaks and there's the whole captioning and that kind of thing. It would be a different thing, but I don't think different's bad. It might be something they could do additionally or alongside. I'm not saying get rid of in-person events, because I love them as much as the next person, but I think it's having a quality alternative for people that wouldn't be able to access it in the first place.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you all for chatting to us there. I'm sure everyone watching will agree there's some really interesting insights that we can take away from that, and some learning from the past year and how we can continue applying it in the future. I'm excited to welcome our next guests now. So we're going to be joined by part of the team behind Aerial Festival. So a big welcome to Holly Goodfellow, who previously worked on Lakes Alive and works alongside Sam Hunt and Luke Bainbridge, Aerial's founders and directors, as the event's producer. I'm also delighted to be joined by acclaimed Kendall solo artist Hayden Thorpe, who is also Aerial's artist in residence. So welcome to you both. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Hi, Simon. Nice to see you.
Hi, Holly. How are you? So Holly, I'm going to kick straight off. We've got you, Hayden. So thank you for joining us. Holly, straight to you. Can you tell us all about Aerial? Where did the inspiration come from? How has it had to change because of COVID restrictions?
So Aerial is a new festival of contemporary music, literature, performance happening in the heart of the Lake District. And it came about because we wanted to showcase the fantastic range and diversity of creativity that happens here on a national platform. So we had big plans for a festival kicking off originally in March 2020, and unfortunately that was bang on when COVID came in. So we had to move online, and we've got a gorgeous platform now online. If anybody wants to check it out, it's at aerialfestival.com, of loads of different types of poetry, performance. We've got some short films on there, just really fantastic stuff, just that will be there forever, we hope, and we'll keep on building that and kind of make sure that although this first year wasn't quite how we wanted it to go initially, that, you know, it becomes part of our legacy, that we've got this fantastic platform of content building every year.
Amazing. Kitchens on adapting. Hayden, I'm going to bring you in. How did you get involved in all of this? How did Blue Crow and then Aerial Songs come up?
Well, I was approached by Sam Hunt through a mutual friend who's a nature writer, Luke Turner. And Sam being a Lake District boy and myself being a Lake District boy, I guess we connected on that front, and I was very excited by Aerial's ambition and felt there was a real opportunity here, both to create work and also to contribute to what I think is a really fertile and inspiring place, you know, creatively. So Blue Crow came about. It was a song that already existed, but it was something that I kind of developed once the opportunity arose, and frankly, the funding and commission that makes these things possible, as all artists need.
Amazing, thanks. I've actually watched Aerial Songs as well, and I thought it was absolutely brilliant. So anyone out there that hasn't seen it, make sure you do. It's also, am I right in saying, it's got the finale billing at tonight's film event. So if you haven't booked onto the film event for tonight, make sure you do, and you can get a shot of that, and it's amazing. So Sam, you touched on that, Hayden, sorry, and you grew up in the area. What was that like growing up in this area? Did you kind of have access to those cultural activities that you wanted?
I think there were a few really important institutions. The Brewery Arts Centre was one of them. But in truth, I think perhaps there wasn't. I mean, I've come to suspect that being an artist requires a certain level of self-sufficiency and ability to go your own way to some extent, but I do feel now with Aerial and emerging kind of communities of artists in the area, I do feel that input and that opportunity will be taken up by the young people of the area. And I know Kendall College and other institutions in the area are doing incredible work that does bring forth generations of creative thinkers. And I think people of my generation and friends and other kind of year groups, I guess I'm aware of, we're a pretty creative bunch. It's a pretty formidable collection of people. Even the other day in Grasmere, I bumped into a girl who I was in a year with, and she said I was on the aerial billing and I did a sound piece, Emma Nuttall. And it's funny how these things, I think, emerge, and it's something we should be proud of and definitely develop as our own.
Amazing, thank you so much. Holly, I'm coming to you. Is it important that young people have access to these experiences in their local area without having to travel to cities to experience them?
Yeah, it's hugely important, and for three reasons really, and one of them being that it's beneficial to the whole community to have these activities that can enrich our lives. And, by creating opportunities for young people, you're creating opportunities for everybody and a more kind of vibrant society. But I think for young people in particular, it's important to have that access because, as it does with everything in our lives, representation matters. And you don't know that career, is available to you unless you see it on your doorstep and you see that people like you have grown up in a similar background, have had that opportunity to access it and to thrive as well. And I think showing that, you can create really ambitious things outside of a city environment is incredibly important. I think having those opportunities from an early age and to be able to get involved in creativity and really explore what your skill set is and what is important to you is, it makes better rounded people and just a better rounded society. Really.
Amazing. So Holly, one more for you. What are the next steps with Air? Can we expect to see little pop-up gigs sometime soon?
Yeah, so we're still kind of working on how our, how we take our online platform and our live ideas and merge them together, but there's definitely going to be something on the horizon, so keep your eyes peeled.
Fantastic. Well, thank you both for chatting to me. Remember, you can visit aerialfestival.com to enjoy all of the commissions from last year's festival. It's well worth a look. Hayden and Holly, you'll be coming back for our final Q&A panel, so thank you. They can make themselves a brew now and relax. So next, I'm very pleased to be welcoming Sarah Bird from Wild Rumpus. Wild Rumpus are an events company who produce large-scale outdoor arts festivals across the country, including Timberfest, Just So Festival, and the Lanterns event at Chester Zoo. They also produce Hinterlands International Rural Film Festival in Skipton, which took place for the first time in 2019 in partnership with GPLD, and will take place again in 3 weeks' time. So, Sarah, welcome. Thank you for joining us. How are you today?
Oh, yeah, I'm good. Thanks very much for inviting me.
Good. Great to have you here. You must be rushed off your feet getting ready for the event in 3 weeks' time.
Yeah, it's quite full on. I guess, well, the year just seems to be zipping by, but we just feel really lucky to be able to put it on at all. So, as you said, the first Tinsland Festival happened in 2019. We're due to happen in 2020, rolled over to 2021, and then the original dates were the 14th, 15th, and 16th of May. So when the roadmap was announced that cinemas would be allowed to open from the 17th of May, it was a little, we were a bit like, oh, we just couldn't believe the dates. Anyway, we're really lucky because the Plaza Cinema agreed to be able to roll it over to the weekend after. So, yeah, we're going ahead 21st, 22nd, 23rd of May. And it's really exciting because it's like the first weekend of cinemas being open in the UK. So I think it's going to feel a little bit emotional, actually, to be back in a cinema again after so long. So, yeah, we're really, really excited about it. And yeah, it's a slightly scaled back version of Hinterlands compared to what it was in 2019 and what we had planned for it in 2020. Just really a kind of placeholder as much as anything. So it's mostly happening in the Plaza Cinema as opposed to previously, you know, as Hinterlands was conceived, was to happen across the town in all of the real variety and versatility of different spaces that Skipton has to offer. But yeah, we're really excited to have a programme of films and music and live podcasts and stuff in the Plaza that weekend.
Cool. Well, it sounds fantastic, and I'm sure it won't suffer at all for the changes. So it brings me on to my other great question. So out of all the places in the world, why Skipton?
Well, so we've done a lot of work on Greenfield festivals, both in the UK and internationally in Brazil and New Zealand and places. And we've also done a bit of work in town centres and urban centres in Manchester and Stoke. And I think what Skipton has to offer is it's got all of the beauty of all the countryside and the environment, but it's that what we really wanted to do with Hinterlands was talk about not just the landscape and the environment, but what it really means to be part of a rural community. And so many of those films that are focused on rurality really tell the stories of and the narratives of the people who populate those communities. So Skipton's just got, so it's got, as I mentioned, it's got such a versatility of spaces where you can show films, you know, from the castle to, we put something on in the barge, in the park, the cattle market. It's got, yeah, such an amazing versatility of spaces. I mean, it's blooming lovely as well, isn't it?
Yeah, that was going to be one of my other questions. Like, obviously, a lot of your work focuses on linking people to the landscape and making the most of their surroundings. But is that a conscious effort, or are you just kind of attracted to lovely places?
No, I mean, we are, yeah. But no, it is. It's quite specific that what we want to do is try and encourage people to look at the world around them differently through arts and culture. And so it's all really about trying to inspire a passion for conservation or a different way to connect with nature. And there's some really brilliant work coming out of Derby University. Have got a nature connections department where they do a lot of research into this. And they talk about the major pathways for people to connect to nature being through beauty, through the senses, through meaning, compassion and emotion. And we think that more than anything, you know, I mean, there's brilliant work happening in wildlife and conservation organisations, but it comes from quite a scientific knowledge-based perspective. And actually we think arts and culture have that ability to use the senses and the emotions to create meaning and create different ways to connect with the natural world. So yeah, it's quite a specific thing that we think that there's a brilliant place for arts and culture there to do that.
Well, it sounds fantastic. Thank you so much for chatting to us again. And Sarah's going to join us on our final panel as well. So that is great. So reminder, if you've got any questions for Sarah, you know what to do. You can open the Slido app or you can visit slido.com. You can purchase that from any of your usual app stores. And whichever way you choose to do it, remember, you can use the hashtag GPLD2. So last but by no means least this morning, I'm going to be joined by two local cultural producers who between them have well over 20 years of experience of producing cultural events and activities in the Lakes and Dales, most recently as part of the teams behind Yarndale and Yorkshire Festival of Story. We'll be joined by Kate Beard, an experienced producer and project manager, having worked on international events for London's Barbican Centre and Manchester International Festival, After several years working with Grassington Festival, Kate is now focusing on other projects, including Yarndale. And also joining us is Charles Tyra, an executive director at Settle Stories, who delivered the first fully online Yorkshire Festival of Story last August and is committed to raising the aspirations of young people in his community. So welcome to both of you. Thanks for joining us.
Morning. Thank you for having us.
Pleasure. So Charles, I'm going to come to you first, if I may. You moved here as a teenager. Can you tell us about what that was like? And do you think it's different for teenagers now?
It was hard. I moved from an urban space to a little village outside of Settle. And I used to just think, well, this is the worst place ever. Mainly because there were so few creative opportunities and that's what I was interested in. I just wanted to leave. What's it like now? I think the fact we're having this conversation today shows progress. I think there's been a massive cultural shift in our thinking towards young people in lots of our organisations. But I do think there's still a long way to go. I think arts and cultural organisations here need to work on representation and relevance for young people. Young people need to see themselves reflected in these organisations, on their stages, in their exhibitions, on their platforms. And it was interesting in yesterday's GPLD Live, something Sian said, Sian Campbell, to quote her, let me look at this here. She said, we need to stop young people feeling like it's an uphill struggle from the get-go. Make young people feel valued and not patronised. Take advantage of their skill set and involve them in the process. It's not what can we do for you from the organisation. And I just thought, yes, that is it. And when I think of my early experiences, that was a barrier that always kind of came up, and I think that's something we need to work on.
Amazing, thanks so much. Yeah, totally agree. Sounds like the right plan to me. Kate, can you tell us a little bit about how you came to be working in this area, and again, just slightly how you found that things have changed through the years?
Yeah, sure. I was brought up here, so unlike Charles, I didn't want to leave. I would quite happily have stayed doing whatever I was doing. But fortunately, my mother kicked me out and said, you've got to go out into the big wide world. I was brought up in a tiny village just north of Grassington. And she had the foresight, I think, to get me out of here and make sure that I got a different perspective. So off I went to work in London and latterly Manchester. But then I wanted to come back. And I fortunately was offered opportunities to work with the festival, to get involved over the last 10 years in events going on. And I think absolutely what you're saying, Charles, everybody should give the opportunities to younger people to make sure that voice is heard. And absolutely nobody should be saying, this is what we can do for you. Like Kennedy's speech, isn't it? We should be making sure that everyone has the opportunity to get involved and lead and be heard. Absolutely, we should be listening to younger voices. We should all have the opportunity to have a voice and be listened to.
Thank you. So as cultural events happening in communities that have an older population, it must be a difficult balancing act to try and cater for everybody. So how have you tried to reach out to different audiences and attract younger people to your events? Charles, perhaps you could take that.
Yeah, I think it's about priorities and as an organisation, listening to and understanding the needs of the community that you're in. So to be honest, I wouldn't say it's been hard for Settle Stories. And I think that's because it's always been, you know, young people have always kind of been high on the agenda for us because they've always been an underrepresented group for us in our community. So yeah, it kind of goes back to representation as well, really. And that's something we've really, really worked on. So for example, with Yorkshire Festival of Story this year, the cover image of the festival was a young artist from Settle, from Craven. The year before that, the image was created by a graphic designer who was from Settle. Half our staff team last year were all under 30. So I think representation is a huge part of it. And, you know, also working with people, working with communities. So we've reached out to community groups. Last year at YFOS, we worked with Craven Youth Council, reviewing our events. And like these little volunteer opportunities, I think they make a big difference in terms of touchstones with the arts. Co-creating work with young people, I think, is absolutely critical. And programming local artists as well. I don't think it's a positive thing to be really insular and just focus on the work of people from your community. I think it's important in rural spaces to broaden horizons and welcome people from different cultures. But I think it's really important also to provide a platform for young artists so other young creatives can see themselves represented on the stage.
Amazing. Yeah, thank you. Kate, providing opportunities for young people to get experience of working in the creative industries close to home is obviously close to your heart. How have you provided these opportunities and how have they influenced what's included in your programme?
I think similar to what Charles is saying, make sure that you've got room on your team for younger voices, for younger people. So the team and the broader team, the core team, basically those in the office and those who are programming, but the broader volunteer opportunities, make sure that you're reaching out. And I think, like Charles has said, making sure that you look like you're welcoming younger people. So that imagery is really important. And I think that's something that we're struggling with a little bit with Yarndale now, because the knitting community is not known as a younger community. They are middle-aged to older, grey-haired women. And we would love to make sure that younger people are represented, but that is really difficult. We look through our images from the show and crikey, that is a sea of grey hair beyond belief. But you've got to make sure that you look like you're able to welcome and want to welcome. So that imagery and the roles that are there. So with Yarndale again, our team over the weekend, the festival weekend, is mostly younger people. The older people love that, bizarrely. Maybe that's a great thing, but you've got to, your program has to reflect younger people and your team and your imagery, so you look like you're able to represent and will represent.
Brilliant, thank you so much. I'm sure Nita go mad and take off for sure, and I think it's great that you identify that. So thank you so much. I'm delighted to come by the rest of our guests for our final panel. So welcome back, everybody. I'm going to go to Slido. So let's see what's at the top of my list. Hayden, I've got one for you. Does it feel more special to perform in front of your local community?
I think so, yeah. No, I was due to play a show at St Mary's in Ambleside with Ariel last year, and it's something we still definitely have in mind. I think it is very special to play to the local community. It's incredibly nerve-wracking too, but I definitely kind of came up playing Dicky Doodles in Kendal and various venues around the area, and I think it was a nurturing atmosphere, and I think it's really important to represent, and I also feel the area has great potential to be important on the kind of live music circuit. I think we have venues like the Brewery Arts Centre and various other places that I think bands will want to come to and musicians will want to come to, and for various reasons, both for the area and the inspirational kind of scenery, but also to kind of play to the audiences here.
Great, thanks so much. Holly, I'm going to come to you. Is it more difficult to put on festivals in rural settings? And if it is more difficult, what can we do to change that?
Oh, that's a very good question. I think, every place you go to has its own pros and cons, doesn't it? I think, there are some things in terms of infrastructure that we have to bear in mind when we're programming in kind of rural areas, but on the whole I think there's a very similar set of challenges than there is anywhere else. It's just all you need is the passion of people to want to go to it, and it all spins out from there. I think definitely supporting and being creative in yourselves, and if you've got some bright ideas, I think that we should be encouraging as many people to say,
just because, you know, you live rurally doesn't mean that you can't do that here. You don't need to wait until you go to a city, you know, have those conversations. If you're passionate about something, let's start this culture of having more pop-ups and more festivals and creating the vibe that you think you have to go to the city to get right here.
Great. Yeah, couldn't agree more. So Sarah, I've got a question for you here from Slido, and it is there a bright future for rural events and the rural creative economy, and how do we ensure this?
Yeah, I think there definitely is. And I think if the pandemic has done anything, it's kind of like pushed people centrifugally out from those urban spaces and made them realise that they can have everything that they want in that rural space and have the connection to nature as well. So I think the more people have realised what's actually important to them and what's resilient in a kind of post-pandemic world, the more they realise that creative enterprises in rural locations are a brilliant thing. And I mean, we feel really lucky right now because we're about to put on a film festival, and the Oscars is like dominated by films like Nomadland that are about rurality and about rural spaces. I think it's just become inherently so much more important to the narratives that we're telling ourselves. Definitely.
Great, thank you. Yeah, it's a great answer. Charles, I've got one for you here. Rural communities are at the heart of our events, but with more future digital events, how do we keep that connection to our special places alive?
Well, that's a good question. I think, you know, in a sense, what the last year has shown is that we don't need to be, we can be anywhere to do anything. We don't need to be in a rural space. And there's so many amazing artists working rurally. I think to maintain that sort of special connection to a sense of place, we need to sort of shine the spotlight on rural communities. So there has been a big shift in terms of people thinking, yeah, actually rural's quite cool because I don't want to be stuck in this tiny little space because I can't go anywhere. So I want freedom to walk around and to roam and to be part of a community. I think community has been a huge thing for everybody in urban and rural spaces in the last year. And that's what we should be celebrating. So cultural producers, artists, let's celebrate the rural spirit in the work that we create.
Amazing, thank you. Kate, I've got one for you now. How do we balance including international artists with ensuring that there's still a local connection and opportunity to nurture local creativity? That must be quite a fine balance to strike.
Yeah, I think it is. These are all really great questions. Yeah, I think often it comes down to budget, but I think there are so many more opportunities opened up with a virtual festival. So, you know, you get rid of the costs of travel and accommodation and be able to reach out much further than we ever may have been. I mean, my more recent experiences with festivals that work into very tight budgets, but I think everything is a balance in programming, isn't it? You need to balance so many different audience members, potential audience members, and your program needs to reflect both the community, what Charles was saying about your community, and your desires to widen horizons and get people to think beyond what they think they want to see and enjoy, and show them new avenues, new landscapes, new broaden their horizons in every possible way. So we keep balancing, walking that funny old tightrope.
Amazing, thank you. Right, I'm going to put the pressure on now. I want each of you really one sentence, quick responses to the big question: is the future rural? So Holly, over to you.
100%. I think if it's not now, after the pandemic, then I don't know which way we're going. But yeah, for me, the future is definitely rural.
Thank you, Charles.
Oh, stressful question. Honestly, no, I don't think it is at the moment. I think it should be. I think we should be on an equal playing field with urban spaces, but I think we need to address the fact that our rural organisations aren't as equally funded. We can't offer as many opportunities. And until we kind of get the change makers and the funders to listen to conversations like this and to act on it and invest in us, it's not going to be. But I hope it will be.
Thank you. Kate, one sentence for us.
Yes, it should be, but it isn't yet, and we have to keep working to make sure that it is. So yeah, we need to push it. We need to push it and make sure people know that it can be and it will be.
Thank you, and I'm sure we will. Sarah, quick thought from you, please.
Yes, it is, definitely. But absolutely, we need to look at funding. We need to look at infrastructure and accessibility. But yeah, of course it is.
Thank you. And then to wrap us up, Hayden, is the future rural?
I think it has to be. I think we need to be ambitious and visionary. I think, you know, 90% of UK land is farmed. And considering the environmental concerns, the more bold and the more ambitious we are, I think that will resonate. And I think we have to be very positive in our and forthright in what we would like to achieve.
Amazing. Thank you all for chatting to me. Really appreciated all of your thoughts. Thank you to all of our guests today who have joined us. We hope this is a whistle-stop tour of some of the amazing projects and people connected to Great Place Lakes and Dales. I think this is a really interesting event. It feels like a call to action for me. So hopefully this promotes further conversation and gets everything moving forward even more than it already is. So that is the end of our GPLD live episode 2. We still have the second film night tonight at 8 p.m. You can still book onto that via Eventbrite, so don't miss out. GPLD have been able to support so many local creative projects via their branching out and aid schemes. With so many people receiving funding, it's not been possible from everyone who benefited today. But to play us out, here's an overview of the 32 projects that have been supported with a few words from just a handful of people who told us about the impact the funding has had. Enjoy.
Part of what GPLD aims to do is to revitalise the rural creative economy in Craven and the South Lakes, and to change perceptions of the area to make it a more exciting, vibrant and appealing place for younger people to live, work and create.
This has brought me leaps and bounds closer to being able to work full-time in the creative industries, and now I am actually able to work full-time. GPLD helped facilitate some really exciting training opportunities. Being a part of this has given me a greater sense of connection to my local creative community. I now feel more supported and valued as a creative practitioner.
Each artist has had the opportunity to explore and realise a creative project and be supported to take that to market. For one, it has enabled them to secure Arts Council funding, which allowed them to make a brand new show which they took to residents in care homes, and local school children were also invited to take part and watch those. For others, it has been a time to germinate ideas, build relationships and develop networks so that they are better placed to work as a dance maker in the Northwest.
My funding has allowed me to get training which has expanded my skill set and added value to me as a professional. It has allowed me to utilise technology I otherwise wouldn't have been able to, and opened me up to many more possibilities of what I could do in the future. Maybe most importantly, it's given me the confidence to take on new work and try out different projects. I hope I'll be able to use this to improve my own career, but also to share my knowledge as an educator.
The funding allowed us to bring a wide range of authors from the UK and beyond, and to build new audience both from nearby and further afield.
It has been especially rewarding to be able to offer free writing workshops with visiting authors supporting creativity in our vibrant community.
It boosted our confidence in our own programming, and it confirmed to us the need for high quality literary events that were free at the point of access in the lakes.
We're excited to see what grows out of this seed funding to support an internationally renowned authors to come to Grasmere and to share our conversations through our podcast.
Working with Great Place Lakes and Dales has been such a great opportunity for me. It's helped me pursue my passion for events whilst opening up a range of networking opportunities and collaborations which will help me further my career.
The project to date has looked at issues of
ecological concerns, sustainability, accessibility, and questions of care. Over the research and development phase that we've just undertaken, the project has connected a diverse group of people through a collaborative approach. These include hobbyists and amateur builders, young people with an interest in architecture, sustainability, ecological issues, and building, women who want to upskill and retrain, and professional architects and designers.
GPLD would like to thank everyone who applied. We look forward to working with you again in the future and seeing what our next chapter might bring.